गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल। इन आवर लास्ट क्लास वी स्टडीड अबाउट द एसोसिएशन कॉर्टेक्स और द नियो कॉर्टेक्स व्हिच इज फाइलोजेनेटिकली द न्यूएस्ट पार्ट और द मोस्ट रिसेंट पार्ट दैट इज हाईली डेवलप्ड ऑफ द सेरेब्रल कॉर्टेक्स। केम टू नो द वेरियस फंक्शंस ऑफ द नियो कॉर्टेक्स। वी टॉक्ड अबाउट सेरेब्रल एसिमेट्री because the two cerebral hemisphere has got discrete functions and depending on this discrete functions it is also divided into dominant and non-dominant hemisphere. Dominant hemisphere mainly concerned with the language function, whereas non-dominant hemisphere is concerned with the visio spatial relationships like recognition of faces and so on. Then we had a discussion about what is the anatomical and biochemical basis for these differences of dominant and non-dominant hemisphere. We studied the relation of hemisphere differentiation with the handedness. And we came to know that left cerebral hemisphere is considered as the dominant hemisphere. Now, let us continue our discussion on the cortical areas of the brain with lobes of the brain. As we have studied previously also, each hemisphere of the brain is consisting of four lobes: frontal lobe, parietal lobe, occipital lobe and the temporal. Before we proceed with each and every lobe separately, we should know what is Broadman's classification system. German anatomist Corbinian Broadman in the 20th century generated a map of the cortex, and this map is covering lobes of each of the hemispheres. He numbered the areas that he studied in each lobe and recorded psychological as well as behavioral events that accompanied their stimulation. Let us begin our discussion with the parietal lobe. What is the location of parietal lobe? This particular lobe is the parietal lobe. Posterior to the central sulcus and rostrodorsal to the lateral sulcus, that is Sylvian fissure. And it has got two divisions. Anterior division, which is mainly containing primary somatosensory cortex, that is Broadman's area 3, 1 and 2, this particular one. And the posterior region, it contains other sensory areas which is considered to be the association sensory cortex. And this include area 5, area 7 and area 39 as well as area, this is area 39 and area 40. 5, 7, 40, 30 association sensory cortex. Afferent connections of the parietal lobe area 3, 1, 2 constitute primary sensory cortex, and it is receiving inputs or afferents mainly from all the sensory modalities through thalamus. Area 5 is receiving input from the cortex as well as thalamus. Cortical inputs come from the somatosensory area 1 and thalamic inputs come from nucleus lateralis. Cortical inputs provide somatosensory and vestibular information. Area 7 also receive input from the cortex and thalamus. This particular area we are talking about. Cortical input come from peristriate visual cortex and provide somatosensory and vestibular informations. Thalamic inputs come from the pulvinal part of the thalamus. Inferior part of the parietal lobe, that is area 39 and 40, receive input from superior temporal gyrus, prefrontal cortex, inferior part of parietal lobe, that is area 39 and 40, is receiving input from the superior temporal gyrus, prefrontal cortex, area 8, 45 and 46. Area 45 and area 40. this part. And cingulate cortex, that is area 23 and 24, which is seen on the medial aspect of the cerebral, 23 and 24. Efferent connection. Unlike discrete efferent connection, efferent fibers have common and mostly overlapping destinations in the cortex, basal ganglia, as well as in the subthalamus. Area 5 mainly project to premotor and motor cortices, in particular. And area 7 is projecting to parahippocampal gyrus and subcortical area. What is function of this parietal lobe? Area 312, perception of sensation, especially cortical sensations like stereognosis, tactile localization, two-point discrimination, fine touch, proprioception. Area 5, processing of somatosensory information to produce the movement. And area 7, process visual information in order to produce not only movement, but also arousal, attention, and emotion. After being discussing the afferent and efferent connection, what will be the effect of lesion if taking place in the parietal lobe? The first and foremost is the hemineglect syndrome. Individual in this particular syndrome ignore stimuli which are originating from the contralateral half of their bodies, though they do not have any primary visual, auditory, or somatosensory deficit. In severe cases, they do not dress half their bodies, do not shave half their faces, do not eat from half of the plate, or even read half of each page or two. Language defects. Patient with the left parietal lesion have difficulty with second half, but not the first half of words, both in writing as well as in speaking. Some patients with parieto occipital lesions write only with consonants and vomit the vowels. Motor defect. The most striking defect is inability to reach accurately for objects. Lesion of area 5 causes deficient in tactile reaching, and lesion of area 7 causes deficient in visual reaching. Sensory deficient. Loss of all cortical sensation resulting in asteriognosis, loss of tactile localization, and loss of two-point discrimination. And damage to somatosensory area 1 causes severe impairment of fine touch, vibration, and proprioception. Pain, temperature, and crude touch are less affected. Lesion of area 5 and 7 impairment occurs in learning and retention of the various tasks. Deficit in spatial perception. Brain receives sensory information but unable to integrate for spatial orientation, which is resulting in both inaccurate reading and wrong interpretation of the tactile cues. There will be difficulty in dealing with the three-dimensional space. Bilateral parietal lesion causes spatial deorientation. Patient cannot find its way even in the familiar surrounding. Attention deficit. Motor and sensory deficit in posterior parietal lobe lesion may also be due to defect in attention. Right? Hemineglect, there will be hemiattention. They ignore stimuli from contralateral side of. Constructional apraxia. What is basically inability to copy an object or even simple design. Apraxia means inability to perform organized movements in absence of any sort of parallelism. In bilateral lesion, there will be abolition of visual placing, though tactile placing will be retained. After the parietal lobe, let us now discuss about the temporal lobe. This particular part of the brain now we are talking about. Or this particular lobe of the cerebral lobe. It has got three divisions: superior temporal gyrus, this part, middle temporal gyrus, or an inferior temporal gyrus, and medio basal portion of the temporal lobe. Superior temporal gyrus, that is area 22, 41, and 40. This particular. Area 22, 41, and 42. Area 41 and 42 are said to be the primary auditory cortex, which are receiving input from medial geniculate cortex. It is projecting to area 22, which is crucial for understanding of speech. Area 22 receive input from periosteal visual areas and project to frontal lobe, parietal lobe and cingulate gyrus. Thus, area 22 processes visually perceive words and symbols. Inferior temporal gyrus, that is area 20, 21 and 37. This particular part, it is concerned with the vision. It receives input from periosteal visual areas, pulvinar of the thalamus and parietal lobe, and projecting to the periosteal visual areas again, amygdala, entorhinal cortex, as well as the basal ganglia. Mediobasal portion of the temporal lobe. Anterior part of temporal lobe, which is concerned with limbic function and olfaction, it is consisting of amygdala, hippocampus, other limbic structure, peripiriform cortex, and other cortical areas which are concerned with the sensation of olfaction, as we can see here in the diagram. Effect of lesion of temporal lobe leads to a condition called prosopagnosia. It is lesion involves inferior temporal lobe. It is inability to recognize known faces, though patient can identify people by their voices. Even he may not identify his own face by observing himself in a mirror. This is not a perfect perceptual deficit. Patient usually also have achromatopsia, that is cerebral color blindness. Auditory deficit, mainly in auditory discrimination learning. Though temporal lobe receive heavy input from the medial geniculate body, lesion in superior temporal gyrus produces deficit only in distinguishing between complex sound, that is auditory task. Visual deficit. Lesion of the inferior temporal lobe results in difficulty for learning new visual discrimination tasks. Also, previously learned tasks are not remembered. Visual perception is less affected and visual memory is significantly disturbed. Memory deficit. Lesion of the left temporal lobe leads to or affect verbal memory, and lesion of the right temporal lobe affect non-verbal. Lesion of lateral temporal cortex affects short-term memory, whereas lesion of hippocampus and amygdala of the temporal lobe affects long-term memory. Clover-Bussy syndrome. As first described this condition by the Clover and Bussy in experimental animals, hence the name Clover-Bussy syndrome, it is caused because of the removal of temporal lobe on both the sides. The animals are called Clover-Bussy animals. Frontal and prefrontal lobes. Frontal lobe, part of the cortex, rostral to central sulcus or the precentral sulcus and medial to sylvian fissure. This particular part. It is divided into three parts: precentral region, transitional region, and prefrontal association cortex. Precentral region, that is primary motor cortex area 4 and premotor cortex area 6. This particular part is called precentral region. Area 4 and 6, these areas control movements, both skill as well as postural. Transitional region. It is the area between precentral gyrus and the prefrontal cortex and includes area 44 and area 8. Area 44 and area 8. 44 motor speech area that controls motor activities of the speech apparatus, whereas area 8 frontal eye field area that controls the movement of the eyeballs. Prefrontal association cortex, also called as prefrontal lobe, it is consisting of area 9 to 4. 9, 10, 11, 12 to 14. Orbital region, area 11 to 14 and 47, and dorsolateral region, area 9, 10, 45 and 46. That means this particular part is prefrontal lobe. Area 24 of the prefrontal lobe in the cingulate gyrus is a part of Papez circuit which plays an important role in the genesis and control of emotion. Orbital region, it is connected with the temporal lobe, olfactory cortex and limbic structure. Dorsolateral region receive input from various sensory modalities that include visual input from the periostriate cortex and inferior temporal gyrus. Auditory inputs from superior temporal gyrus. Prefrontal cortex provide powerful neocortical connections to basal forebrain structure, including the hypothalamus. What will be the effect of this particular lobe? Motor deficit, lesion of the motor cortex will cause hypertonia at rest and inability to react in terms of past experience. Postural reflexes are preserved except hopping and placing reactions. Unable to perform a delayed response task and preservation. Limbic dysfunction. Prefrontal lesion causes limbic dysfunction, especially emotional shallowness, impairment of memory as well as learning capacity will be also the feature of limbic dysfunction. Personality changes in frontal lobe lesion. Lack of initiative and inability to assess personal performance. Tactlessness, change in social habits, impaired concentration, disturbance in judgment, and tendency toward irresponsible behavior. These all personality changes can also be observed in the frontal lobe. Prefrontal lobotomy and frontal lobe syndrome. What is prefrontal lobotomy? It is disruption of connection of thalamus with the prefrontal lobe. Major areas of the prefrontal lobes are area 8 to 12 and area 44 to 47. They are described. It is associated with frontal lobe syndrome and characterized by difficulty in planning due to flight of ideas, sense of well-being, that is euphoria, and failure to understand the seriousness of the other's feeling. Loss of recent memory with impairment of moral as well as social sense. Loss of attention and ability to concentrate. Decreased mental drive and lack of initiation. Emotional instability may be associated with hyperphagia and urinary and fecal incontinence. Coming on to the last lobe, that is the occipital lobe. It is the area of the brain posterior to the parietal occipital sulcus, which is mainly concerned with vision and mainly containing the area 17, 18 and 19. Area 17 is said to be the primary visual cortex. 18 and 19 are the association visual cortex or higher order of visual cortex. Cortical plasticity or neural plasticity. What is it? It is the ability of synaptic connections between the neurons to undergo modification in the central nervous system, and this modification, especially when taking place in the brain, it is said to be the cortical plasticity, as the plasticity is taking place between the neurons, hence other term that is neural plasticity is applied. It occurs in some special circumstances like postnatal modification, changes as a consequence to injury to the brain, and plasticity during the learning or experience. Let us consider one by one. Postnatal development. During this early phase of development, many neural changes occur due to environmental effects like change in the cellular, axonal, and synaptic parts of the neuron, increase in number of synapses until maximum levels are gradually reached in early adulthood. Response to injury in adulthood. In poikilothermic vertebrates, axons in the central nervous system, if damaged, show enormous capacity to undergo regeneration. And this regenerated new neurons or the connection function near normally in the body. In homeothermic vertebrates, regeneration mainly occurs in the peripheral nervous system, and following injury to the central nervous system, regeneration is incomplete. However, significant modification do occur. For example, axonal sprouting occur following spinal transection, also in hippocampus, septum, cerebellum, and radionucleus. In some cases, new connections have formed functional connections. Example, cerebellar projection to red nucleus is preferentially to the soma and proximal dendrites of the neurons, whereas cortical projection to the red nucleus primarily ends on distal dendrites. Damage to the cerebellar efferents to the red nucleus cause cortical projection fibers sprout to establish more proximal connection at the synaptic site. And these new connections increase the influence of motor cortex on the red nucleus, which contribute to the recovery of motor. This is the best example said to be for the cortical plasticity. Learning and memory. Capacity of certain neurons to change their behavior as a function of environmental inputs serves the basis for learning and adaptive behavior. Learning refers to a process of change in behavior as a result of previous memory. It is a storage of information of experience-induced modification. This involves actual physical changes in neurons, change in synaptic connection, and cellular changes are the basis of learning and memory. This is another example of the cortical plasticity. With this, we comes to end on the neocortex, the association cortices, the various lobes of the brain, that is frontal lobe, which is mainly concerned with the motor activity, parietal lobe with the sensory activities, temporal lobe mainly concerned with the audition and olfaction, and the occipital lobe, which is mainly concerned with the visual. Thank you.